back here at home, the families of victims of the Philippine government's war on drugs cry for justice. And more of them are coming forward to help the International Criminal Court in its possible investigation into the drug war. We have with us today attorney Christina Conti, member of the National Union of People's Lawyers. She represents several victims' families. Attorney, good afternoon, and thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, good afternoon, Rain.
The Victims Participation and Reparations section of the ICC is asking whether these families of victims wanted the ICC prosecutor to investigate the charges against Mr. Duterte and why. But Justice Secretary Guevara said it would be hard to prove a claim if victims don't come forward with their evidence. First of all, how many families do you represent? How many have submitted their testimonies, data, and evidence? And what is the response to the VPRS?
Well, first, as to the numbers, Rise Up, Rise for Life, Life and for Rights, which is the organization we support, has documented over 200 cases, 200 families, 200 killings. Seven of those, eight victims in total, have come forward and submitted documents to the ICC. When we submitted our communication, we already gave them the police reports, affidavits, and all the other supporting documents. These seven, you can be assured, will be going forward into the next stage of the ICC investigation. Now, as to this VPRS, now we'd like to clarify that at this stage, what the ICC requires is just reliable information. So they don't really need the excess information that we've given, that these are primary sources, secondary sources of what really happened. In the VPRS form, in the representation form, they will just be asking for your story. They will be just asking for a straightforward retelling narrative of what happened to you and what you want to do with the investigation. What's important is whether you or you want this investigation to proceed or not. The other matters about you being a victim, that's just for a qualifier for you to be considered, for your views to be considered, because they're asking victims to come forward. Many have been very interested in this proceeding because, to be frank, again, the ICC is not asking for additional evidence at this stage. They're just asking for views. What do the victims want to do with the investigation? And with that, we think that this will snowball eventually, with even people messaging me on Facebook, messaging me on my phone, asking if they can participate at this stage.
Right. And at this point, there's no money involved, right? There's no estimate, perhaps, of how much in remuneration they're looking into?
No, that's right. The reparation stage will come after trial. During the sentencing stage, they will give you an amount or a figure for reparations for all the victims, and then thereafter, that's only a matter of distribution. So it's really a long way down the road, reparations. First, we must focus on the investigation. At this point, really, Rain, the ICC has just established that there are crimes against humanity in the Philippines. That's just about it, based on reliable information. The next stage, which the Office of the Prosecutor is asking permission for, is to proceed with investigation. Oh, sorry, that was preliminary examination. So this is investigation. This is a mix of what we have in the Philippines, because what we have here is the preliminary investigation. The second part is the determination of who is most responsible. And at that stage, only after we have finished that, do we go into trial and get all the and present all the evidence that we have to convince the judges that the persons who are most responsible are indeed guilty of the crimes.
Right. And at that point, the families, of course, want President Duterte ultimately accountable for these drug war deaths and alleged vigilante killings. But how do you prove that exact link between the suspect, in which case it's President Duterte, and the crime and the victim? What do the families think the ICC investigation should include?
The ICC investigation should clearly establish the link between Duterte's orders and what's happening on the ground. What the families have right now would be documentation of how their kin have been killed, of police operations on the ground, which is why we have all these police reports, all these death certificates, even autopsy reports. Now, we have to link it to a pattern, to a policy. We already do have documents regarding policy, and it's straight from Duterte himself. All his statements regarding the killings have been submitted to the ICC. Also, circulars, orders, directives from the different departments have also been collated and analyzed. In addition to that, what the investigation team could look into would be perhaps testimonies or statements from mid-level policemen who could quite link the killings on the ground and that to the policy or directives from their superiors or higher ups. And if we can establish that as early as now, that the killings are happening because Duterte ordered the policemen to do this, then we can have a clear case of crimes against humanity, which would include not only police operations, but as you said, also vigilante killings. Because this climate of impunity, this entire situation where people can take advantage of the lack of accountability mechanisms, and also the lack of police intentions or police enthusiasm in going after the killers. There seems to be a great lack of enthusiasm on that part. In fact, from what I've heard, the police consider the killings to have been solved because they have already killed the suspect. They don't, they'd rather focus on the original crime, quote unquote, which would be the buy bust or the selling or the possession of drugs. But actually, there's a second crime. And that second crime is the killing, homicide or murder of a person. And that's what the police should be investigating. They're not doing that.
Mm-hmm. How confident are you about the kind of evidence that we will be presenting, and not just the testimonies and the stories? Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque calls the probe legally erroneous and politically motivated. Among the pieces of evidence to be submitted are news reports, but aren't they considered secondhand information, and would the ICC even consider those?
Oh, so just to clarify, Rain, at this stage, again, it's preliminary examination and even onwards to investigation. What is required is reliable information. All right. So reliable information could consist of news reports as well as UN reports of the human rights situation in the country. That's reliable information. However, if we move on into trial, of course, that's a different level, that's a different quantum of evidence required. That's when we're going to give all these documents. So far, from what we've understood, the OTP has refrained from disclosing all the evidence that she has, but she has hinted that she does have primary evidence and witnesses in her report. So we're looking forward to that. Mm-hmm.
August 13 is a deadline for the representation, is that correct? How many of your supposed testimonies or witnesses have encountered the perceived risks in filing those complaints, or risk of further intimidation and harassment for victims and witnesses?
Well, right now, Rain, as to the numbers, as I said, we have the 7 core incidents that where the families have already signed documents or the representation form. We're going around the communities where Rise Up has members, and so far the feedback has been great. And so we're looking at somewhere above 200, perhaps up to 500 representation forms or 500 incidents that will be submitted or documented, and whose views, victims whose views will be forwarded to the ICC by August 13th. And that's just not us, all right? That's just us. And there are many other groups that are working on that. So, but also, just to note, the ICC, the VPRS in particular, has already said that the numbers don't really matter. It's more of the quality that they are looking at. So whether they get one or 1,000 feedback, they will consider all of this. Now, I understand the victims have been feeling quite anxious over what's happening because they think that submitting their names will put their security at risk. We've been doing our best going around and explaining that the information will just be available to the ICC and not to the government or not to the respondents at this stage. So disclosure of the names and their addresses and the incidents will not be public, will not be forthcoming anytime soon. So we're trying to allay their fears at this stage, but I think we just really need to get together all these victims so that we can gauge their support of the process.
Mm-hmm. Well, apart from the seven, you mentioned about 200 to 500 victims' families could be considered complainants who can file this application for participation in court proceeding and for obtaining reparations before the ICC. And what kind of timing do you expect the pretrial court to follow? Do you think this may drag on, especially considering the pandemic and the lack of cooperation from the Philippine government?
Oh, Rain, sorry, but I'd have to clarify on that. At this stage, they're just asking for views.
Sure.
All right? If we want to participate during trial, that's a separate registration. If you want reparations, that's a separate registration. So every step of the way, every stage, the victims need to register or to tell the court that they want to participate at this stage. So right now, what the ICC is just asking, most important in the form is, do you want the ICC investigation mm-hmm. to proceed? Mm-hmm. That's just it. Mm-hmm. They're not going to consider or they're not going to put as evidence what you put in the form. Mm-hmm. That's not going to be automatically considered. So right now we're not looking at reparations for those who will sign up here. Mm-hmm. There are no incentives or monetary incentives for the families. But our families have been looking at this as a kind of process whereby they can be heard by the ICC. It might be the only time, if possible, to be heard directly by the ICC, because otherwise, during trial, it will be the OTP to decide who will be standing up in court. So, and it might not be everybody. So this is the point that the court may hear from everybody.
Right.
Well, now, yes.
Yeah, with 1 year left in his presidency, do you think the ICC would be able to complete its investigation soon enough to make President Duterte at least tag him for his alleged sins? What can we reasonably expect from the ICC at this point and what kind of timeline?
Well, I cannot speak for the ICC, but we are looking at from the previous cases mm-hmm. And investigations decided by the court, looking at somewhere between 1 to 3 months decision time with regard to the investigation. As to the investigation, it could run from months to years, but in any case, we are prepared for that. Even if Duterte steps down as president, he can still be held accountable. We're looking at, in fact, a possibility that even if he runs for vice president, correct? Even if he sits in whatever position eventually in the next administration after 2022, he will still be within the ambit or within the jurisdiction of the ICC. So wherever he goes after this, we think that the ICC can still go after him.
In which case, what kind of support do you need moving forward in order to sustain this case?
Right now, we need the views of the victims for them to fill out the forms. Yes or no, do you want this investigation to continue. And we're just not talking about victims who have dead relatives, dead from police operations, dead from vigilante killings, or unexplained disappearances. We can also consider, the ICC can also consider, those who have suffered, say, financial harm, psychological harm. And because the prosecutor is also looking at acts constituting crimes against humanity, other inhumane acts, those who have been arrested, released, those still in jail, those who have been taken into police custody, whether legally or illegally, those who have been accosted by the police in any way related to the war on drugs, or have been harmed from what they perceive because of the war on drugs, they can come forward and say yes or no, we want this investigation to continue. And who, there's also a question there, who they want to be investigated, or to what extent they want the investigation to proceed. If after that they still want to continue with the different stages, trial, reparations, perhaps they should weigh their options as well. And if possible, well, reach out to organizations like Right Up for Life and For Rights so that they can be represented at all the stages of these proceedings.
I'm sure we'll be watching this case very closely in the coming months. Attorney Christina Conti of the National Union of People's Lawyers, thank you so much for sharing your updates and thoughts with us. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Rain.